wird jetzt um umweltfreundliche Webseiten gehen und was WordPress damit zu tun hat und wie man das alles zusammenbringen
kann. Okay, this talk will be about green websites and what WordPress has to do with that. It's a 15-minute talk. There will be a break with a bit of Q&A.
Wenn Fragen zwischendurchgestellt werden, bitte ganz kurz halten, genauso wie ich mich.
If you ask questions right in the middle, don't take too much time.
Setzt sich gerne hin.
If anybody is still standing, then sit down. And you can talk about the last talk outside, please. Thank you. Welcome and have fun.
Könnt ihr vielleicht noch die Sprecher anmachen? Das wäre toll.
Ich glaube, jetzt, okay. Genau. Danke für euer Interesse.
Thanks for your interest in this project.
15 Minuten sind jetzt nicht so viel.
15 minutes ain't much. I'll try to go as fast as I can to tell you the concept of the ideas behind Green WP. It's about climate-friendly WordPress websites, which is something I'd like to have or that I'd like to motivate you all to.
Die Frage stellt sich erstmal, was verstehe ich,
was versteht man
unter einer klimafreundlichen Website?
A climate-friendly website?
Da gibt es sicher verschiedene Modelle und Ideen.
Highly probably many different models and ideas. I had a bit of a look.
Erzähl es eher, was ich darunter verstehe.
I'll be telling you what I understand.
Es geht ums Klima, es geht um die Auswirkungen in dem Fall von Website aufs Klima.
Es geht um den Energieverbrauch
und das Ganze ist natürlich ein bisschen schwer abzuschätzen. Es gibt verschiedene Zahlen
zu Energieverbrauch von Internet, von Rechenzentren.
Und es gibt zum Beispiel auch Zahlen zum Energieverbrauch von Informations- und Kommunikationstechnologie als Ganzes. Da gehört dann
Information
and
communication technology as a whole uses.
The internet
is part of that, but also TV and
other
technologies. And there is a number that about 10% of global energy usage is for ICT, so information and communication tech.
Ja, also sind so, also natürlich wieder je nach Schätzung, so 5-10%. Und das entspricht aktuell ungefähr 2%
right now,
des CO2-Ausstoßes weltweit,
of our CO2 emissions
ungefähr
worldwide,
dem Ausstoß
von
Fuel, also von Sprit, der Luftfahrtindustrie entspricht.
Which
also es ist schon auf jeden Fall signifikant in dem Bereich und das Internet, das Web ist natürlich Teil von ICT.
So the Internet and Web are part of the ICT sector.
Und dann kann man überlegen, okay, wie viel nimmt tatsächlich das Web davon ein?
Think about it, have a look.
Da gibt es auch verschiedene Statistiken, zum Beispiel kann man sich den IP-Traffic anschauen.
There's a lot of different statistics, so you can have a look at IP-Traffic.
Zum Beispiel im Internet.
And how it,
ganz oben haben wir gerade aktuell
Streaming-Dienste,
also sowas wie Netflix, YouTube.
At the top we have streaming services such as Netflix, YouTube.
They have about
67%.
Beim Web, und auch da ist die Frage, wie man Web definiert, aber da gibt es dann zum Beispiel so eine Zahl, 20-25% des IP-Downstreams
ist das Web,
was nicht beinhaltet, der Schätzung zu tun hat, soziale Netzwerke und auch nicht
This
Videos auf Websites, also es ist eher noch ein bisschen mehr. Also das heißt, wir haben einen großen Energieverbrauch für ICT,
so we're burning
wir haben
a lot of energy for ICT.
Einen wesentlichen Anteil auch fürs Web,
and a significant also Websites, part that is the web.
Und es wird halt auch immer mehr, so wenn man sich den IP-Traffic anschaut,
more.
Der verdoppelt sich ungefähr
if you
alle
look
18 Monate,
ICT traffic,
also es wird
doubles
deutlich
about
mehr werden
every
die nächsten Jahre und Jahrzehnte. Das heißt, man kann schon mal überlegen,
a lot more in the next years and decades.
Vielleicht mal ansetzen.
So you should maybe have a think about putting some leverage on that. Aside from energy usage, there are other negative aspects, especially in production, for example, with the production of electronics and electrical devices. You have rare materials, such as the rare earth elements. They have to be dug out of the ground, out of mines. You have a lot of child labor in that sector, shitty work conditions in factories. And of course, you have all the junk that's left over and partially toxic. Sorry. So you're burning a lot of energy, you have other negative aspects to the whole thing. And I'm going to focus on energy usage. And I'll say a climate-friendly website is a website that, compared to other websites, uses less energy. What's that mean? How do you achieve that? You have to take a look how that energy usage actually comes into being. So if you have a general look at ICT, there's four categories. The energy used to run the consumer devices, then the energy used to run the network, energy for the data centers and servers, and the energy used in producing all that. Right now, those four categories are about equal at 25% each. That will probably shift over the next years and decades because more and more people are using smartphones that use less energy. So the traffic, that is the energy used for the network, will rise significantly because the IP traffic will rise. It's going to be more efficient, but usage as a whole will rise. And a thing you can do is have a look at the direct energy usage, which is mostly network traffic. But you can also reduce the energy used in producing your hardware. If you have more complex websites, you need more complex and more powerful devices to run them on. So if you're using a 5-year-old smartphone to try to access a website. Sorry, does this mean I've still got 10 minutes or these are 10 minutes? Oh, I've still got 10. Okay, I was a bit scared. Okay. You can reduce the energy used in production of hardware by trying to build the websites in such a way that very old tech can still access them. That's actually a bit more significant than reducing the energy uses of the device itself. Sure, if we're visiting a website with, for example, a smartphone, that'll drain the smartphone's battery. But if you have a look at the lifetime energy usage of one of those, then you have 80 or 90% energy used in production and about 10%-ish during actual use.
So you can do all of that pretty efficiently by designing these websites more lightly. If you look at a website from right now, they all get more difficult to access. There are many pictures, there are many videos, there are videos in the background, there's web fonts, and very difficult to run scripts and sheets. So the size of a website is about 4 megabytes at the moment. 2 years ago it was half as much, and 10 years ago it was only a few kilobytes. That's just the trend at the moment. Of course, there's the background that a picture and a video also conveys some meaning to the user. You get attention by doing that. You may also trigger emotion. That's very important in marketing, and websites are also marketing most of the time. So this is wanted, and energy levels aren't really relevant in that decision. I do also come from web development, and it's hurt very few times to have to develop a website with a category of energy savings in mind. You can also see that very well by looking at your data usage or your web traffic. So if you want to design a climate-friendly website, you might want to consider these categories more carefully. You have to think about if you do want videos, pictures, do you want more difficult web fonts, or is it maybe just enough to use whatever? Now I'll probably arrive at the project I'm doing. This is where Greener WP comes into the playing field. It's about a more sustainable web. I myself come from the WordPress community. I thought this was a very good project to reach many people. Because WordPress is kind of a very big part of web development. There's a giant user base. There's over 6 million people using it. So you'll reach developers, private people, and also development companies. So it has a lot of potential. I thought you may be able to do something with that. A little overview over this project. I've been working on this for 3 months. It's funded by Prototype Fund as well. It's a bit younger. It's also in the project phase right now. It's open source and non-profit as well. Right now it consists of a website. It's not only a technical project, it's also about optimization and technology. My point is, you have to think about which content you offer on a website. It's not only optimization, because by optimization alone you won't be able to achieve much, because the more efficient something gets, the more people use it. I do also want to talk about content. So there's this website which has a lot of background info and guides and how-tos. There is also a website scanner. You can use this scanner to type in your website as a URL, and this machine will generate a rating of your website. It will also give you direct hints at what you could improve. There's also a WordPress plugin for people who host websites themselves. They can optimize this, and they will get step-by-step tutorials on how to improve. There are also tweaks, like loading of images or web fonts, or deactivating web fonts. Right now this project is worked on in the sense of features. I'm looking into whether a usual WordPress user can use this efficiently. What is also important for me is to communicate to the users. So, because why use this if no one recognizes? Maybe there should be some reward in using this, and you could tell your users, hey, I'm better than other websites. I'm thinking of multiple different things about how to do this. If you have feedback, look at the project. Some things you can think about again, the background of this, what is optimizable, what is not. Look at it, try it, give me feedback. You can, I'm sure you can add to this. There will be today, and there have already been interesting talks about this. Just find out more knowledge about this topic. There has to be more information here. Maybe there's some time for 2 minutes of questions. Do reach out to me. I will be here on Congress for the next few days. It's not only about WordPress, it's about everything. It's a nice possibility just to optimize.
If you have a question, just put up your hand and I'll give you the mic. First of all, what's your big difference, except for example the Google PageSpeed tools? The other thing is, what's your opinion on gray robots and such? So everything that isn't commercial but doesn't burn a lot of traffic, has like 75% of its page views through Majestic or SEMrush or something else that's just checking backlinks. So you maybe would be able to save a lot of stuff just with a simple robots.txt on the server, because the robots will stay away.
So firstly, these scanners are based on Lightspeed, these tools from Google. There's small little differences. The evaluation of these pages are also about how quickly does this page load. It won't be negatively rated if the website just continues on loading after the main page is loaded, which is bad for energy efficiency. I do things differently in that I use other measuring systems, other measuring factors. It isn't really a big difference in implementing these and not implementing these. It's not much work. Of course, it depends on the pages, what is sensible to optimize. You might have to lock out bots. That would be a possibility. Of course, it's about talking about these things and making these things popular. I try and just make people sensible for this problem, which the sensibility for that isn't there right now. So I'm trying to talk to people, hey, if you were watching Netflix, if you were watching YouTube, you don't always need to watch things in full HD or 4K. You might be able to save some energy or and mobile data by not doing that. So, of course, I'm from the WordPress area. This is just my small little contribution to this topic. Thank you.